First Senator John McCain, welcome back to Meet the Press.
Thank you, David. Thanks for having me back again.
Always happy to have you here. I want to start with some breaking news this morning. The front story in the New York Times is that former Vice President Dick Cheney kept Congress in the dark. His orders to keep Congress in the dark about a covert CIA program. It's a program that CIA Director Panetta has now shut down. He's briefed Congress about it. What do you know about this, and what's your reaction to it?
Well, uncharacteristically, not a lot. I'm not on the Intelligence Committee. I don't know what the details of this are. The Vice President, I think, should obviously be heard from if the accusations are leveled in his direction. Clearly, the Republicans did not sign a letter, apparently, that was written alleging this. So I think it's frankly too early for me to reach any conclusion.
It doesn't appear as if any lines were crossed, in your judgment?
I don't know, because again, a lot of this is anonymous sources, and this is, if I know Washington, this is the beginning of a pretty involved and detailed story, and I don't have enough information, but I think a lot more is to come on this.
Should there be an investigation, you think?
I don't know. First of all, I'd like to know the facts of the case before there should be an investigation. How long did the director of the CIA know about this program, and when did he terminate it? And all of these things are probably going to be heavily discussed in the weeks ahead.
Speaking about investigations, there's now word from Newsweek magazine today with a story about the Attorney General that he's getting closer to investigating alleged torture during the Bush administration. This is the reporting from Daniel Kleidman that Holder may be on the verge of asserting his independence in a profound way. Four sources telling Newsweek that he's now leaning toward appointing a prosecutor to investigate the Bush administration's brutal interrogation practices. Would that be a good idea?
No. I fought against waterboarding. I said waterboarding was torture. We passed the Detainee Treatment Act, which prohibited cruel and inhumane treatment. I have spoken out as forcefully as possible everywhere against what went on, and that we need. It harms our image so much around the world when photographs come out. And we all know that bad things were done. We all know that the operatives who did it most likely were under orders to do so. For us to continue this and harm our image throughout the world, I agree with the President of the United States. Mm-hmm. It's time to move forward and not go back.
But where's the accountability?
Well, the accountability, obviously, is that people's reputations have been harmed very badly. The question is do we want America's image harmed more by dragging this out further and further? You got to, what's going to be the positive result from airing out and ventilating details of what we already knew took place and should never have, and we are committed to making sure never happens again? I do not excuse it. I'm just saying, what's the effect on America's image in the world? I don't mean to drag out my answer, but I did meet with a high-ranking member of al-Qaeda in a prison in Iraq who said his greatest recruiting tool was the pictures of Abu Ghraib. We don't want to give the terrorists and the radical Islamic extremists more tools and bullets to shoot against us and help their recruiting in this ongoing struggle we're in.
Let me turn to politics. You must have been shocked to see Governor Sarah Palin resign as governor.
Well, I wasn't shocked. I was a bit surprised, but I wasn't shocked. I understand that Sarah made the decision where she can be most effective for Alaska and for the country. I love and respect her and her family. I'm grateful that she agreed to run with me. I am confident she will be a major factor in the national scene and in Alaska as well.
But you say you were surprised a little bit. Why?
Well, because she had not called me. We've discussed it since, and I better understand the reasons for her decision.
What were they?
Well, how could she best serve? How could she most effectively serve Alaska and the country? And that was her decision.
But, Senator, you have a reputation of mm-hmm. personal and mm-hmm. professional toughness and mm-hmm. stick-to-itiveness. Mm-hmm. You sought the highest role in the land, President of the United States. Mm-hmm. You never quit.
No, I don't think she quit. I think she changed her.
She made a promise to the voters to serve out her term, didn't she?
I don't know if there was a, quote, promise, but I do know that she will be an effective player on the national stage. And I will say, I have never seen the sustained personal family attacks that were made on Sarah Palin and her family in my life. Carl Cannon has a very interesting piece about the media establishment and the attacks that were made on her, and I'm sure that that had some impact. The ethics charge after ethics charge, hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of legal fees. But the fact is, she is very popular with our Republican base. She will be a strong voice. I chose her because she was a reformer, because she beat an incumbent governor. She was a popular Republican of her own party. She ignited our base. She did a great job as my running mate, even under the most sustained personal attacks that in right. certainly recent American
but
political
Senator history. McCain, you have faced personal torture, personal attacks, political attacks, investigations. You have never resigned from anything. Is it consistent with your qualities of leadership to resign an elected post like this?
Sure. If you think
it is consistent?
You can be, if you can be, the question is how can you serve most effectively? Sarah and Todd and her family made a decision that she can be most effective by stepping down as she did. I respect that that position and that decision, and I cannot tell you the appreciation I have for her.
You think she's qualified to seek highest office in the
land? I know she's qualified.
She is qualified.
Sure.
No doubt about it.
No doubt about it. She has all the right instincts, all the right principles. She was a mayor. She's a governor. She understands the challenges that families face. She has a great background, and I am confident that she will continue to play, as I say,
and
a major role.
If she seeks the presidency in 2012, you would endorse her?
I think it's way too early for that thing because she obviously has not made that decision yet. And traditionally, those of us who were the nominees have waited at least a long period of time before we got into that. But we got a lot of good, strong, young, attractive, articulate spokespersons for our party and our principles.
But can you understand how people would think it's a little bit strange? You vouched for her in front of the country, said mm-hmm. she was qualified for the highest position
Absolutely.
In the land, and
Absolutely.
Yet you're not prepared to endorse her now?
Well, I mean, George Bush, Ronald Reagan didn't endorse George Herbert Walker Bush, his own vice president, until the year of the election. I mean, it's just way too early, but I'm confident she would make a fine president. Question is what's the whole political scenario?
Do you think she'll run?
I don't know. I know she will play a major role. I know she has the ability to ignite our party and to galvanize us and get us going again and give us a strong, positive message.
One more on this.
Sure.
Your trusted advisor for many years, Mike Murphy, wrote this week something very pointed. He writes that Governor Sarah Palin is the political train wreck that keeps on giving. First, she was an awful choice, he wrote last year as John McCain's running mate, an inexperienced governor of a small state. She lacked the experience to be president and brought nothing to the ticket except a surefire knack for exciting voters who were already reliably Republican. It was a strategically awful choice. Knowing everything you know now, you would pick her again?
Absolutely, and in all due respect to those who like to examine the entrails and look backward, the fact is we were 3 points ahead on September 15th, and the stock market crashed, and we went 7 points down. Sarah Palin ignited our party. We were winning, and we could have won, but I'm proud of the campaign we ran. I'm proud of the people around me. I'm grateful for their support. I love them. I am proud to have had the honor of being the nominee of the party of Abraham Lincoln and Theodore Roosevelt and Ronald Reagan,
and
I will remain so.
Is she ahead of the pack in terms of leaders of this party going forward?
I don't know. A recent poll I saw shows she and Mitt Romney and Huckabee very tight, but it's so early. You might remember in 2007, my campaign was dead.
Right. Remember well, and you came back. Let me switch gears a little bit, talk about the President of the United States currently, and that's Barack Obama and his performance. Look at the recent poll numbers that came out, and it shows declining support. His approval rating now 58%. Back in January, it was at 66%. What's your assessment of how he's performing?
Well, first of all, those numbers are still strong, so they're relative. Second of all, I think Americans, understandably, are becoming very, very concerned about the deep political, economic debt that we are laying on future generations of Americans. We are committing generational theft. Just last week, the estimate of the deficit was $1.1 trillion just for the first 9 months. It's going to be $1.8 trillion. That's by a factor of two, the highest in any time in peacetime history. I mean, we are spending and spending and spending. Who 5 months ago thought we would own Chrysler and General Motors? Who thought we would own AIG? Who thought we would own all these banks and institutions? It's a most massive movement from the free enterprise system to the government in the history of this country.
The president says, be patient. Mm-hmm. How much more patience do you have?
Well, I also think it was interesting. The president uses a very effective rhetorical ploy. He says, he sets up the position of the opposition. Like he said, there are those who said we wanted to do nothing. Who was that? We wanted to have a stimulus package. We wanted one that would help small business, the generator of jobs in this country, that would cut the corporate tax from 35 to 25, that would help small businesses buy equipment and hire people. That and would have immediate shovel-ready projects. And we predicted that most of this quote, stimulus package that was passed through the Senate in a partisan fashion would not have any real short-term effect. So guess what? We're finding out only 10% of the money has been spent. A lot of it has been on ridiculous projects. So I say with respect, we Republicans had a positive alternative. It was over $400 billion. We've had an alternative budget. We had an alternative to the omnibus spending bill.
And but 40% of the stimulus package included tax cuts.
It included tax cuts, but a lot of them were in the wrong direction. Why not make sure we focused on small business and also on corporations, which now have the highest tax rates of any country in the world?
Here's what his top economics advisor said this week, Larry Summers, to the New York Times. People know that problems of this seriousness cannot be turned around in 6 months or 9 months, Mr. Summers said. One of the president's strengths in his extraordinary candor is his extraordinary candor. The president has been honest with the American people about the enormity of the challenge and the amount of time it will take to turn things around. Then the president yesterday in his radio address said, this Recovery Act has worked as intended. Is he leveling with the American people?
Well, I'm sure the president is doing everything that he can to try to help this economy.
But is he leveling? Is he being straight?
He's either not leveling now or he wasn't leveling at the time of the passage of the stimulus package because they said the maximum unemployment would be at 8%. That was what they told us. It's 9.5 going to 10. They said that most of these projects were shovel ready and the money would go out very, very quickly. We know now that that has not happened. And even that 10% is a little deceiving because it really hasn't actually been used. So what they promised us would be the result of the stimulus in a short term has turned out not to be true. So I'm not saying that it's, quote, not leveling, but it's certainly not factually correct because they said unemployment would be a maximum of 8% and probably closer to 7%.
Could you support a second stimulus plan if it comes down?
I think that would be the biggest mistake we could ever make. Why don't we focus on tax cuts? Why don't we focus on small businesses? Why don't we, instead of saying we're going to increase taxes to pay for health care reform, why don't we say, look, let's ease this burden on small businesses particularly. And I keep going back to that. Who generates jobs in America? Not General Motors, not Chrysler. People that generate jobs in America, the small business people who all over my hometown of Phoenix, Arizona, are shutting these storefront enterprises of theirs. And yet, General Motors is too big to fail, and so is AIG, but they're too small to save. There's something wrong with that picture, and that's why the American people are unhappy.
You mentioned health care reform. This is what the president said back in March. He said, look, this is critical to the overall financial health of the country. Listen.
If we want to create jobs and rebuild our economy, and get our federal budget under control, then we have to address the crushing costs of health care this year.
Do you agree?
I agree that we need to reform health care and we need to make it affordable and available. But we're losing sight of the fact that the highest quality health care in the world is in the United States of America. That must be preserved. So the key, what we should be focusing on, is affordability and availability for all Americans. I don't think that these proposals are doing that. I was at MD Anderson in Houston, people, with Senator McConnell and Senator Cornyn. We did a health care town hall. People from 90 countries all over the world were there. They could have gone any place in the world. The best, highest quality health care is in America. It's the cost that's the problem.
Are you prepared to support what the administration is proposing on health care?
Well, the latest was by CBO that we still
Congressional Budget Office.
Yeah, the Congressional Budget Office, after saying we're $1 trillion short and only covered a third of the people who are uninsured, now about half of them are uninsured under this plan. Look, we got to give people the ability to go across state lines to get the health insurance of their choice. We've got to have, we're in agreement on prevention, on wellness, on trying to have outcome-based health care, a whole lot of areas we're in agreement on. We should be sitting down now across the table, not trying to do what they did with the stimulus package, with the budget, and with all the others, and that is pick off a couple of Republicans. Let's sit down and have some real conversations, some real negotiations, rather than the charade that we've been going through.
The House says, House Democrats say, we need to raise taxes, a tax surcharge in order to pay for this. Does that kill this effort?
I don't know if it kills the effort, but it kills our economy. What, I don't think there's any rationale for raising taxes on anybody at this particular time in the economic difficulties that we're in. And look, malpractice reform is another thing that's been taken off the table. We need to have that as well. That could save us tens of billions of dollars a year because of the practice of defensive medicine that doctors have to engage in.
A couple of foreign policy notes. Look at this striking statistic out of Afghanistan released this week. The number of roadside bomb incidents, these are the ones that were successful, that hurt or killed people. Back in June of 07, 24, June of 2009, up to 82. That's got to trouble you.
It troubles me enormously, but we all knew that once we went into areas that have been controlled by the Taliban, particularly in Helmand province and in the south, that casualties are going to go up. British just took a terrible blow this week, as you know, with 10 British soldiers killed one day. Look, this is going to be long and hard and tough, and I want to work with the president, but we've got to remember what worked in Iraq, and that is it requires additional troops if necessary. Listen to our military leaders. I saw on the front page of the Post this morning, General McChrystal may say we need more troops. Let's tell the American people how tough it is. Let's tell them that what's at stake, and I want to work with the president and make sure we win this thing. But let's not try to go back to the Rumsfeld era of trying to just go out, kill people, leave, and try to get out of
there. Is that the risk of this administration
now?
That's
the risk. That's the risk.
You think we need more troops?
I know that we should listen to General McChrystal and the leaders on the ground who, according to news reports, not my information, say we are going to need additional troops in order to really secure. And we talk about economic, political, military. First, you've got to provide a secure environment. We proved that time after time.
In terms of Iran, the president says by September they abandon the program or get into negotiations or face consequences. What does this administration have to do now to get that change, to get them to abandon a nuclear program?
Look, this is one of the toughest challenges we face. Again, we all want to work with the president. Meaningful sanctions need to be imposed, but also we need to tell the people of Iran who are struggling for a free democracy and an open society and elections that are fair, that we're with them morally. I'm not talking about sending arms. I think the seminal event was the death of Neda on the street that was broadcast all around the world. That will fundamentally change the future of Iran because she was the symbol of an oppressive and repressive regime. And I think the winds of change will even blow through Iran. Now, whether it does quickly or not is hard to say. We didn't predict the collapse of the Berlin Wall, but it happened, and I believe that in Iran, something is afoot that can't be stopped.
Before you go, are you prepared to support Sonia Sotomayor to be on the Supreme Court?
I want to see the hearings, obviously. Those are a very critical part. Obviously, she's a great American success story, and we all respect and admire that. I'd just like to see the hearings and watch very closely, starting on Monday.
All right. Senator McCain, thank you as
always.
Thanks
for having me back on.
Appreciate it. Up next.